Let's bow for a word of prayer. Dear God, we thank you for this opportunity that we have to join you this Sunday evening for a time of worship, albeit virtually. And Father, over our computer screens or television screens, but Father, nevertheless, we're always grateful for these opportunities to look into your word, to sing songs of praise, to pray together and approach your throne of grace with confidence. Father, we pray that you will bless this time that we have tonight, that we will grow our faith, that we will put our faith into action, Father, that our faith, what you have done, will be seen through the things that we do in response to your great gift of salvation. Father, thank you again for this time of study and worship this evening. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hallelujah, praise Jehovah, from the heavens praise his name. Praise Jehovah in the highest, all his angels praise proclaim. All his hosts together praise him, sun and moon and stars on high. Praise him, all ye end of heavens, and ye floods above the sky. Let them praises give Jehovah, for his name alone is high. And his glory is exalted, and his glory is exalted, and his
precious friend.
redemption. Roll my burden of sin away, and is walking on beside me, growing nearer day by day. That is why I sing his praises.
That is why
joy is mine.
That is why forevermore,
on the everlasting shore,
I shall sing of love divine.
He is everything to me, to me.
He is everything to me, and everything shall always be. I will never cease to raise a song of gladness in his praise. Here and there in the world above, my soul shall see the saving love. Life and mine and joy is he, the precious friend.
Glory be to him forever, endless praises to Christ the Lamb. He has filled my life with sunshine, he has made me what I am. Oh, that everyone would know him.
Oh, that all would adore.
Oh, that all would trust the love
of the mighty friend above,
and be his forevermore.
He is everything to me, and everything shall always be. I will never cease to raise a song of gladness in his praise. Here and there in the world above, my soul shall see the saving love. Life and mine and joy is he, the precious friend.
Good evening. Thank you for joining us once again for another night, another Sunday night virtual assembly. I heard a story one time of a man who was in a coffee shop and he was drinking his coffee and he looked out the window and he saw two men working alongside of the road. And one man had a shovel and he would dig a hole. And after he dug the hole, the other man would come along behind him and would immediately fill up the hole that he just dug. And they would just keep going like that. One man digging a hole, the other man filling it up, and they would just keep going down alongside the side of the road. And it frustrated the man who was having his coffee. He didn't know what was going on, and so he tossed his coffee, went outside. He said, "What are you guys doing? One of you is digging a hole, the other is immediately filling it up." And the worker said, "Well, you don't understand, mister." He said, "We work for the government. And normally there are three of us. There's me and there's Elmer and there's Leroy. It's my job to dig the holes. Elmer plants a tree and then Leroy comes and fills up that hole." And he said, "Elmer called in sick today and so he wasn't able to come in, but that shouldn't stop me and Leroy from doing our work." And I think probably that story illustrates the frustration that sometimes we feel with work, maybe with government work, but even with church work. You've heard the adages, you've heard the expressions before, 20% of the membership does 80% of the work. I think I've heard that my entire life. And I get tired of hearing it. I'm not saying it's not true, but I get tired of hearing that over and over again. Nothing around here ever gets done. I'm the only one that's working. Why isn't anyone helping me? Why isn't anyone working with me? And sometimes we complain about the efficiency of the work. It's not that there's not a lot of activity and a lot of things being done. It's just that sometimes we don't feel like anything's really being accomplished. It's as if we're digging holes and then immediately filling up those holes. Well, tonight I want us to look at some passages that talk about our labor, our work in the kingdom. And there are a number of those passages that we can look at, but I'd like for us to start in John chapter 5. John chapter 5, if you want to open your Bible there. And the setting here is that Jesus has been ministering in Galilee, and only John records this particular brief trip to Jerusalem. Jesus is going there for a Jewish feast, likely for the Passover. And just as Jesus has begun to face opposition in Galilee, he also faces opposition here in Jerusalem. specifically after he heals a man who's been lame for 38 years. And the authorities immediately begin to investigate this healing because it has occurred on the Sabbath day. And listen to this conversation that ensues in John chapter 5, verses 16 through 18. So because Jesus was doing these things on the Sabbath, the Jewish leaders began to persecute him. In his defense, Jesus said to them, "My Father is always working. To this very day, I too am working." For this reason, they tried all the more to kill him. Not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he was even calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God. And the primary thrust of this passage, are the only red letters that we see in this verse, is Jesus' comment, and it's a statement of Jesus' divinity. Jesus says, "My Father is at work to this very day, and I too am working." In other words, if God doesn't rest from his labor, why should Jesus rest from his? And now it's true that God observed that initial Sabbath after he finished his creative work and the Genesis account. But by and large, God doesn't take days off. There's not a day that God doesn't hear our prayers. There's not a day when God isn't working providentially in our lives. He doesn't put up a shingle and say that he's closed on Christmas Day or on New Year's Day. And Jesus can't ignore human need any more than God can ignore human need. God is always working, and therefore Jesus, his son, is always at work every day of the week, all the time. And I believe there's something in here for us. Why is it important that we work in the kingdom? Why is it important that we labor in the vineyard? Because our Father is always at work. And if we share his heart, we too will be working. Now, understand that there are some unhealthy extremes when it comes to church work or to kingdom work. On one hand, at one extreme, you have people who live according to a very legalistic standard of works righteousness. They're really, really working hard because they want to earn their passage into heaven. They want to get that ticket to heaven. And at the same time, they always fear that they've never quite done enough, that they've never quite accomplished enough. They're working hard, but that work isn't healthy. And if my reading of the book of Galatians is correct, they might even be jeopardizing their own salvation because they're putting their trust, instead of putting it in Jesus' saving work, they're putting it in their own work and accomplishments. And so that's one extreme. But then at the other extreme, you have those that view work as a dirty four-letter word. They're always talking about freedom that we have in Christ. They're talking about the biblical doctrine of grace, but they're misappropriating that. They're misunderstanding that, to the point that they never lift a finger in work. God's done all the work, so I don't have to do anything. Well, Scripture, as it often does, has a beautiful way of bringing those things into balance. And look at another passage with me. This is one of my favorite passages to preach from, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10. Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." Let me share with you Eugene Peterson's New Testament paraphrase of that passage in the Message. "Saving is all his idea, his work. It's God's gift. We don't play the major role. If we did, we'd probably go around bragging that we had done the whole thing. No, we neither make ourselves or save ourselves. God does both the making and the saving. He creates each of us by Christ Jesus to join him in the work he does, the good work he has gotten ready for us to do, work that we had better be doing." Now, I can't do any better than the Message paraphrase, but I'll take a shot at paraphrasing Paul's words. We're not saved by works, but we are saved to work. And works are the fruit and not the root of our salvation. And that really puts things into perspective. Salvation is by grace through faith. We know that. Scripture teaches that. But as recipients of grace, we understand and we recognize that there is work to be done. And it might even be viewed, can even be viewed as an act of grace that God has given us work to do, because that gives purpose to our lives. It gives meaning to our lives. It gives us a reason to get up every morning. And the passage says that God is at work. He's prepared work for us, and we'd better be doing the work that he has prepared for us. And so in light of the New Testament, a very valid question to ask is, what role do works play in the life of a believer? And the first thing we need to understand is that works are a response to the gift of salvation. Look at another passage with me, this one from Luke chapter 7. How does gratitude manifest itself? Well, let's look at this from an event. Let's look at this event in the life of Jesus. Luke chapter 7, and we're going to start in verse 36. When one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. A woman in that town who lived a sinful life learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, so she came there with an alabaster jar of perfume. As she stood behind him at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she's a sinner." Jesus answered him, "Simon, I have something to tell you." "Tell me, teacher." "Two men owed a certain moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii, another 50. Neither of them had the money to pay him back, so he forgave the debts of both. Now, which one of them will love him more?" Simon replied, "I suppose the one who had the bigger debt forgiven." "You have judged correctly," Jesus said. Then he turned towards the woman and said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman from the time I entered has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven as her great love has shown. But whoever has been forgiven little loves little." And Jesus said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." And so Jesus goes to this banquet hosted by Simon the Pharisee. And one of the prevailing customs at this time is that when there was a big feast, when there was a big banquet, needy people from the community would come just in hopes of, not to sit at the table, but just wait outside in hopes of getting some of the leftovers. But that doesn't seem to be the motivating factor for this woman who comes to see Jesus. She's not there to receive. She's there to give. That's why she brings this jar of perfume with her. And this woman who's lived a sinful life, and maybe that's just a kind way of saying that she lived a life of prostitution. At least that's what some scholars and commentators believe. She starts weeping before she even sees Jesus face to face. She starts weeping. Some of those tears fall on Jesus' feet. Maybe at this point she fears that she's committed some type of social faux pas, that she's embarrassed herself, that she's embarrassed Jesus, and almost instinctively she kneels down and starts to wipe his feet with her hair. And then she kisses his feet, and after removing her salty tears, she anoints his feet with that expensive perfume. And Simon the Pharisee, he's put off by this. He thinks to himself what he thinks is a private thought. If Jesus was really a prophet, he would know what kind of woman this is. He wouldn't allow this. Jesus knows what's on his heart. He knows what Simon the Pharisee is thinking. And so he responds with a parable. "Two men owe money to the same moneylender. One owes 500 denarii. Now, in today's terms, that would be over a year's wages. Another owes 50 denarii. That would be about 2 months' wages. But the moneylender forgives the debts of both." And so the question is, to pose to Simon, which one will love him more? And Simon responds correctly, "I suppose the one who had the bigger debt forgiven." Jesus' point is, it's this prostitute, it's not the Pharisee who really gets it. Jesus' grace, Jesus' merciful character is what has prompted her work and her action. And that's what ought to motivate us to work. Not the guilt that we feel, not the sense that our salvation depends on our own performance or the good things that we do, but that God has been gracious to us and God has given us this gift of salvation. And good works are one of the purposes of the gift of salvation. Now notice again in Ephesians 2:10, we are created in Christ Jesus to do good works. When a believer accepts the gift of salvation, they are freed from the concern of trying to earn their salvation. It's a gift. It's not a wage, as Romans 4:4-5 points out. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 13 that any motivation for good works other than love is worthless. You see, good works done for less than good reasons cease to be good. Good works done for less than good reasons cease to be good. If your motivation for doing good is to elevate yourself or to make yourself look good or to receive something in return, those are our lesser motivations. And those don't give us this great sense of purpose. There's a great story about the famed English architect, Sir Christopher Wren, when he was just directing the construction of St. Paul's Cathedral in London. And some of the construction workers were asked by a journalist what they were doing. The first worker said, I'm cutting stones for 3 shillings a day. The second construction worker said, I'm laying flooring in order to support my family. The third construction worker answered that same question by saying, I'm helping Sir Christopher Wren build the greatest cathedral in Great Britain for the glory of God. So he saw a larger purpose in what he was doing. At Robinson Avenue, we have a mission statement. We are glorifying God by growing and reaching. And just think about that first phrase. We're glorifying God. We are on a mission to glorify God in everything that we do. In every ministry, every project, every endeavor, our goal is that God will be glorified through that. Good works done to the glory of God are our purpose. Our purpose for living is to glorify him. And finally, good works are a sign of our salvation. To put it simply, Christians who fail to fill their lives with righteousness and good works have failed to comprehend their own sinfulness and the cost of God's great gift. When we read the book of James, James has some teaching in it that some people believe contradicts what is taught by Paul elsewhere in passages that, such as the one that we looked at a few moments ago in Ephesians chapter 2. See, James says things like a person is justified by what he does, and not by faith alone. Faith without works is dead. Faith without works is useless. And in fact, Martin Luther, one of the leaders of the Reformation, called the book of James an epistle of straw. He didn't quite know what to do with the book of James. But James is simply affirming this principle that good works are a sign and a mark of our salvation. See, James was concerned about those who made these professions of faith and who professed faith in God, but their faith wasn't real. And one of the clearest signs of a false or lifeless faith is the absence of good works in a person's life. James believed in grace. James preached grace. Likewise, Paul believed and taught that redeemed people will live lives that reflect that and will be involved in good works. And so Paul himself speaks of things like straining and pressing on and running the race. And of course, he understands that those things can only be done by the power of the Holy Spirit and that none of them can be done perfectly. But right living will always accompany salvation. So Paul speaks of the obedience that comes through faith. That's what he says in Romans 1:5 and in 1 Thessalonians 1:3. He talks about works produced by faith. And that's really what it boils down to. The faith that we have in our great salvation should move us, should motivate us to action. Jesus said, my Father is working, I too am working. We should say, our Father is working and we too are working. God is at work, and therefore God's people continue to work to his glory. And God bless. Thanks for joining us tonight.
Since the love of God is shed, priceless blessings on my head,
I have made
it my own.
In my own.
I will hide it in my heart, that it never may depart.
It shall rule.
The love of God.